intent to have done anything violent is not at all clear and disallows that person to participate in drug court based on the drug offenses that they might be before the court on.
It's a triple negative. Let's just have staff help. So current law, I'm trying to follow the strikeouts and the end of those sentences. I'm not sure I get it. Current law says that you can't participate if you have an offense under 17185 or 1927.1. Is that the...
And that language is carried.
In the preceding 10 years. Okay. Yeah. So that would say that if you have been convicted of any of the violent offenses under our two definitions, you cannot participate in drug court for the preceding,
preceding 10 years.
Okay. And is this from your history aspect or the current charge in front of the drug court?
Here's your history, sir. If the sentence starts with, if you have been convicted in the last 10 years, or within the preceding 10 years, on line 72.
Would that cover the instant offense?
It is my understanding that as you look at the beginning of H, that it is you're before the court based on a drug conviction. And this is just removes the bar from you participating based on that drug conviction.
I don't think that's true.
Okay.
That's my estimate.
Mr. Chairman, it's either a drug conviction or a conviction that the court has determined that occurred because somebody is addicted to or dependent upon drugs.
And that's the issue. It's not just, frankly, the issue that we keep tripping on here is that it is not just drug convictions, it's other convictions caused by drug addiction. Okay. So this would, the current law precludes those that are violent under those criteria that had within the last 10 years. Does it cover the instant charge?
Mr. Chairman, I would argue that if you have been convicted of the charge, then yes, it would cover even if it is, because just as any adult offenders who have been convicted of an act of violence or a violent criminal offense within the preceding 10 years. So in practice, I believe that if you have these, or if this is the crime you are looking to be referred on, that the courts have found that is, you are barred because of the statute.
Okay. And then this would shorten that to allow participation.
As the substitute, Mr. Chairman, all it does is exempts 18.2-92, which is breaking and entering with the intent to commit another misdemeanor other than larceny or assault and battery. So it says if that is your charge, you are allowed to go into drug court, but keeps all the other violent felonies as bars from your entry into drug court.
Okay, and since you just said that this also covers the instant offense, the current law prohibits the instant offense being that B&E that you just described, but if this change were made, it would allow drug court for that.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
If it is a crime related to addiction or dependence upon drugs.
That's correct, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions for the paper? Delegate Alvin.
I read it as exempting both 18.2-92 and an act of violence as defined under 19.2-297.1. So you think except, that phrase except only modifies this except?
Anybody else have any questions for Delegate Watts? Any member of the public like to be heard?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Brian Grant, Secretary of Public Safety and Homeland Security. Mr. Chairman, you put your finger on it, you've described it exactly correctly. Previous 10 years, if you have a conviction for a violent offense, you're not eligible. The instant offense is violent, you're not eligible. Frankly, the success of our drug courts is overwhelming. I mean, the recidivism rate of those who successfully graduate drug courts is extremely low. We want to expand access to drug courts. This does it in a very, very narrow way. One offense that is nonviolent. The federal code, there's federal funds associated with about three or four of our drug courts. This particular offense that Elliot Watts has put for you is not a violent offense pursuant to federal code, so we would not be disturbing any federal funds. That's why this is so narrowly drawn. And as the gentleman knows and others on the dais know, the burglary cases many times are due to the drug addiction. It's theft that they're supporting their drug addiction for, so there is definitely a relationship. So, and again, importantly, Mr. Chairman and others in the committee, the prosecutor in these cases has veto. The prosecutor has to agree for the individual to enroll in the drug court, and that this bill does not touch that whatsoever. So again, very narrowly drawn, one case, would like to expand the access to drug courts that are overwhelmingly successful.
Mr. Secretary, I mean, the issue about drug courts is the incentives they set up is if you do certain things, the case gets dismissed, right? That's the setup.
Correct. And what we hear from many of the enrollees, if not all of them, is harder to get through drug court than it is to serve their time in a jail or penitentiary.
Okay. Thank you. Any other member of the public like to be heard? So, let me just speak for a minute. I mean, 10 years ago, whenever drug courts first came on, the advocates swore that these were for victimless crimes, where the only person who would ever be taking advantage of this was a peaceful drug user whose only victim was himself. And then what happens is in the field we see mission creep, and this is an example of it, which would be, if someone has broken into my house, all of us who've prosecuted burglary cases know it is a violation of my special space. We hear people say, I was never the same. I never felt the same in that house. We have people sell their houses. We have people put in new locks, new alarms, get dogs, all because their special space was violated. And it is about as far from a victimless, I'll concede it's not violent in the idea that no one got punched in the face, but I don't think it fits in the same category or deserves the same awards that we apply to some of the drug courts. So I do not support the expansion. All right, any other member like to be heard on this bill?
Move to report.
All right, motion has been made to report. Is there a second? Okay, motion has been made and seconded to report the bill. Substitute motion has been made to table. Is there a second?
Second.
All right, all in favor of the motion to table signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No.
Yeah.
Okay. Nice habit. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I may say publicly, the only violence that was done when someone broke into our house when I was 12 years old was my hitting him with a shovel.
We have Delegate Davis, and then we'll do Levine, which is at the same ballpark, and then we have Delegate Philicorn has arrived, which is 1704. Delegate Philicorn, this may be a 15 to 20 minute talk. I'm looking at the number of people that are here. But after that, as soon as they're done, you're up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm here in front of you today representing a group seeking to allow cannabis oil to be used in the treatment of Crohn's disease. This body set a pretty high bar with allowing use of cannabis oil to be used in the treatment of epilepsy, and our goal is to demonstrate the same desire and need for it with regards to Crohn's disease. First, to discuss the significant disease that you do have in front of you. Crohn's disease is a chronic inflammatory bowel disease, typically needing surgery to remove part of the small intestine. Over half the people need a secondary surgery. The disease itself can be both painful, debilitating, and sometimes may lead to life-threatening complications and sometimes loss of life. The present treatments many times prove ineffective, and worse, sometimes the side effects could cause death themselves. There's a number of things being passed out. One of them you'll notice, I think, on the top is a Mayo Clinic article, and for help, just to speed it along, I've highlighted a number of things, but I would direct your attention to page 6 of 14.
Now, can you do this?
Yes, sir.
The first one I said is today, could move the mic just half an inch front away from you.
Page 6 of 14 starts the drug prescriptions that one would be prescribed for use if they were to have Crohn's disease. And if you were to look through these drugs that go through pages 6, 7, 8, and into page 9, I would challenge you to find one that you would want to put your daughter, wife, husband, or yourself on. Most of them have side effects as extreme as causing cancer, causing liver disease, kidney disease, seizures, brain disease, and that's assuming that patients are able to take those as well. And you'll notice in here, in a number of cases, some of these patients couldn't take these drugs anyway, but if they did, the treatment itself would be life-threatening. What we're looking for is to be able to go and actually have utilized a treatment that has been shown in studies, as well as real-world use, to have significant positive impacts on Crohn's disease. And that's what you'll find in the second article that I shared with you by Chris Waller. And it talks about complete remission in nearly half the subjects that were studied with the use of medical marijuana for those with Crohn's disease. And I will tell you, Mr. Chairman, Crohn's disease has no cure. Even cannabis oil and medical marijuana, it's not a cure. It helps bring down the inflammation in that small intestine, but here's the important part of it. I started out by saying that many times this requires a surgery. Well, like I said, over half the people have to have a second surgery, because what happens is when you remove the small intestine and you recombine it, that inflammation starts again, usually where that connection started. So in many cases, this cannabis oil can help prevent the need for one surgery, but if that first surgery is needed, it definitely has a significant impact, puts in remission where that second surgery is not needed. And then lastly, Mr. Chairman, we've all talked here, and I've heard you talk today, about the overall problem we have across the Commonwealth, actually across the nation, with opioid addiction and prescriptions of opioids. And you'll notice that this disease is no different. There's a number of narcotics that fall into that category for pain that we'd like to be able to get people off of, because we all know that snowball effect, that steady slide that happens when you start prescribing opioids. And what you'll find is, in these studies, this cannabis oil can be used as prescription instead of these opioids, thereby decreasing the trend of prescriptions of opioids and opioid addiction, and start to reverse some of the effects that we've been feeling. And instead of prescribing something that's addictive and harmful, prescribe something that's less addictive, less harmful, and has never seen a death from an overdose. So, Mr. Chairman, that's why I'm in front of you today. There's a lot of information here. I have a lot of other stuff I can share with you during some of the Q&A back and forth, but I think I'd like to share some of the stories with those here today.
Okay. So, I certainly have additional questions, but let's go ahead. You said there's some members of the public that would like to be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, anybody else have any questions? He's going to come back to the podium after I'm done. That's fine. So, if any member of the public would like to be heard, or if Delegate Davis brought you, please step forward now. We'd be happy to hear your testimony.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, I come before you today to share my story and ask for your patience. And this is a very personal and difficult story for me to tell. I'm also here to be the voice for other Crohn's patients that cannot physically be here, although I can assure you that they are with me in spirit. My name is Nikki Narduzzi. I am from Stanton, Virginia, and I have Crohn's disease. I was diagnosed at the age of 21. At first, I was able to manage my symptoms through conventional medical protocols. But by the time I turned 30, those medications were no longer able to keep my flares under control. I had probably tried most all of the medications in your packet at one point in time. But it became very evident that my body would not, it could not, sustain an entourage of legal prescription medications. Because while in the short term, they could provide some relief, in the long term, they would begin to wear on my organs, and they did. The sustained long-term use of these medications was killing me slowly. one organ at a time. When I turned 30, I had my first two surgeries within the same year to remove segments of my intestines that were riddled with the disease in spite of all the medications I had taken and all the doctor's instructions that I had followed dutifully. Since then, I have had so many surgeries that I've actually lost count because I spent the better part of the last decade hospitalized, homebound, or bedridden. I missed out on some of the most important and formative years of my children's lives. Sorry. Okay. At a certain point, doctor sent me home on a cocktail of opiates, methadone, fentanyl, sleeping meds because I was in too much pain to sleep, and anxiety meds because I kept crying that I was dying, and nobody seemed to be doing anything about it. I was dying, and I felt like I had no more options to explore, or so I thought. In the middle of the worst suffering I have ever experienced, I had a family member come to me with data on CBD oil and its efficacy in the treatment of Crohn's. Yet three times, I said no. I said no because the reality of my situation was that I could either stay here in Virginia and risk arrest, or I could travel to another state without my family or friends to pursue this medicinal alternative. Neither of these options seemed valid or fair to me. But when I could no longer tolerate the pain, I sacrificed the comfort of home and family to seek out the medicine I considered to be my last hope. Needless to say, it was the right decision for me. Wound care changes became more and more tolerable. My need for all those pain meds began to decrease. I came off all prescription medications. Yet my struggle is not uncommon to Crohn's patients. Although I was able to find an opportunity to reap the benefits of this medicine, many Crohn's patients who live in Virginia are currently suffering because we do not have access to a safe, regulated product. I often think back on my experience and wonder how different could it have been had I had access to this medication earlier. Would I have been able to end my suffering sooner? Would I have been allowed to participate in my children's lives as a mother yearns to? And I believe the answer is yes. So I'm here today to ask you, what information exactly do you need to demonstrate the need for CBD oil access for Crohn's patients? Because Delegate Davis, I'm sure, has provided you lots of facts and figures and studies. I know those as well, so I'm not going to go over them and be repetitive. I would also like to point out that most likely someone will speak in opposition to the bill to remind you that it is a Schedule I drug at the federal level, but the hypocrisy of that is that the U.S. government currently owns a patent which states, word for word, cannabinoids have been found to be useful in the treatment of inflammatory and autoimmune diseases, and that's what Crohn's is. Essentially, I'm humbly asking for you to allow me and patients like me the same access to medical choices currently afforded to epileptic patients here in Virginia. It is the compassionate thing to do. It is the common sense thing to do. And ultimately, it is the right thing to do.
Mr. Chair.
Delegate Gilbert.
Ma'am, do you mind if I ask you a couple questions?
Okay, go ahead.
And I may have been reading the delegate's material that he handed me. And I don't want you to say anything until my clients don't confess in front of a room of people like this, right? Hypothetically, do people, are you aware that people benefit from CBD oil in their treating their Crohn's?
Yes,
is that something you said?
Do because if you, I'm sure in the information that he gave you, and if it's not in there, I can provide it for you. There are two types of CBD receptors, and they're within your digestive system. And you have a natural endocannabinoid system. Your body is made to accept the things that are within the CBD oil for the purposes of controlling inflammation. And it can also help with additional things like regenerative properties in tissue. It can help with nausea. And the list just goes on and on. I'm sure they're all in there, so I don't want to take up your time because I'm in.
No. I mean, this is a road we decided to go down previously, but we had several years worth, as I recall, of families coming in here with children who were obviously, you know, in great distress and were having hundreds of seizures a day.
I would have been here earlier if I could have.
No,
appreciate that. Yes, ma'am. No, I appreciate that. What I'm telling you is they worked on us pretty hard and to convince us that this was something where there was a nexus between the medical issue and the CBD oil being a source of relief for that condition. And the delegates, one of his articles that he handed us just refers to people smoking marijuana and that having some relationship to the easing of symptoms. But do y'all have any literature on the CBD oil and
yes, crumbs? Yeah, we do. Yeah, just that. And really the oil contains THCA. Obviously, you know that's non-psychoactive,
yes, ma'am.
But it does the same, has the same healing properties. Within the oil, because it is non-psychoactive and it's not just the THC, you do lose some of the benefits of pain management, but you still retain all the other benefits of what THCA can offer you.
Which is the reduction in inflammation.
Inflammation, okay. Yeah. And there are some studies that show that it helps moderate long-term and chronic pain.
Well, one of our concerns generally, I guess, is number one, prove it to us, right? I think that's fair, at least. And number two, something we don't want to necessarily do, and I think there's a senator who has a much bigger bill that's much more ambitious than this one. So certainly we don't want to just keep every year coming back and adding a new condition
right.
to the what we call the Christmas tree hanging ornaments on it.
Right.
And so I just wonder if anybody's ever looked at this comprehensively. Again, our only experience with it, I think, or most of us on the subcommittee, was just those families with the children with the various
right.
epileptic conditions.
This is an awkward position for me to be in. Obviously, I'm not great at speaking. I felt like it was necessary.
You're better than him.
Right. So just, you know, as a citizen, it's hard for me to discuss the medical aspects with people that are more geared towards criminal law. Like, I don't know how to, I'm not an actual doctor. I can give you my anecdotal story.
No, we're terrible at that. We would all go to medical school if we weren't so bad
right.
at science. So,
that's something that you got, like, I'm sure you obviously have staffers and people to help explain to you the studies. Because I've had to have help understand them as well. But if I know what you're looking for, I'm absolutely confident that I can provide it to you. The information is out there, not just in writing, but in anecdotes.
And I appreciate that. And everything I know about CBD oil and Crohn's disease, I've learned in the last 15 minutes. So that's part of my problem right now is I don't like to make decisions like this on the fly. And again, with the other... With the other condition, we had several years worth of hearing about it before
we
got there.
Approach the bill, and then by the time for a full vote, we can educate you.
Oh, that'd be great. Thank you. Yes,
Delegate Elbow, Delegate Davis, I was upstairs for a moment. Do you have something that says there have been clinical trials with CBD oil and it helps Crohn's patients?
There is.
I'm sorry.
There is some discussion that the oil is more impactful than the smoking of it. The initial study that you see in front of you is the smoking that's more than 21 patients. There have been some studies on CBD oil, which I'd be happy to share. I've got one in front of me where it talks about the CBD is able to control the inflammatory scenario and is regarded as a promising therapeutic agent. But, sir, what I found to be more impactful was listening to some of these people's stories. I'm not a doctor either, and it took me quite a while for me to understand the stuff that I'm already digesting today. But what I do understand is all those drugs that's applied, those are the full list of drugs. And when I saw that those drugs cause cancer, those drugs cause other side effects, in some cases arguably much worse than Crohn's disease, and that's all they have to take. And I'm being told by people who have actually taken cannabis oil that they don't have to take those opioids anymore. That's the only proof I needed, but that's the study I was able to provide you, sir. And I've had some other numbers I can give you, but nothing probably to the extent that maybe you're looking for where we gave people cannabis oil and those people no longer have Crohn's. Keep in mind that Crohn's never, ever goes away. You don't cure it. It just goes into regression and prevents that third, fourth, fifth, and sixth surgery that the gentleman was talking about.
Mr. Chairman, so what we had with epilepsy was that there's been studies of people with intractable epilepsy who got CBD oil, and their number of seizures were reduced by X percent. New England School of Medicine or Mayo Clinic or something. So, but you don't know if anybody's ever done a controlled study on CBD in Crohn's.
Well, at least know one. But it just does, no, I do not know. I just know from reading the articles that it says it definitely impacts inflammatory. You've got one in front of you. And when that article talks about its impacts on Crohn's disease, that is cannabis oil. And I've got others that I can probably give you a stack of about 10 if you like, that talked about the impacts of cannabis oil on Crohn's disease as an anti-inflammatory and preventing additional surgeries. What I can't tell you, delegate, and give you is a study that says we gave cannabis oil to 20 patients in a controlled environment, and 8 of them now didn't need that additional surgery a year down the road.
Okay, see if I can find a new example.
Mr. Chair. So is part of the problem that you don't have your hands on that study is that the feds have kept it as Schedule 1 such that it can't be properly studied?
I thank you for raising it the way you did, but that probably is exactly the situation. I've done more Google searches and called more people trying to see if I can put my hands on exactly this, and what you have in front of you is as close as I can come.
I understand.
But that world stories that I'm being told and reading about what cannabis oil does and its impact on inflammation is as close as I can come.
Well, Mr. Chair, I just, again, if we could, saying something has no scientific or medical value when there's ample anecdotal evidence that it does for some people seems ridiculous to me. And if we could do, at the state level, if we could do anything to encourage the feds, not to say it's okay or that it's legal or that it doesn't have harmful effects, but that it should be a Schedule 2 instead of a Schedule 1 or whatever, that would go a long way, I think, toward providing us the kind of proof that we need to go down this road. But anyway, that's neither here nor there.
Other member of the public who would like to be heard? Yes, sir.
Thank you, Chairman and committee members. My name is Kevin Mulgey. I'm with Normal, but I'm wearing my personal hat on this specific issue. My sister was diagnosed with Crohn's disease when she was 19, and she died shortly after. There were several contributing factors to her passing, but I'm confident that based off the feedback that I've received from people who reach out to our national office, plus some of the testimony that I've heard here in Virginia, that this CBD oil can provide a better quality of life. I understand and respect the need and desire to have more data to back it up as something that could help actually provide medical value. But at least at this point, I encourage the committee and the chairman to really take a serious look at this issue. Because a lot of people out there are suffering, and I think at the very least they should have an affirmative defense so that they don't have to end up in the courts. So, thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir.
Later, here's what happened. You gather a ton of evidence that way, and it could be a nuisance and a lot of work to sort through it. But you get the evidence, and that's more than receiving the coming from the feds.
Yes, ma'am. Identify yourself and tell us your
James Lennonsworth. I'm also with Virginians Against Drug Violence. And I want to make a point of information at this point regarding the danger and the federal policy about marijuana and THC and CBD. There is a medicine that's been on the market for some years called Marinol. It's a pill. It's 100% THC. It's Schedule 3. Okay? It's not Schedule 2. It's Schedule 3 because it's considered that level of safety. So this goes back to, you know, these complaints that it's not your daddy's marijuana from the 70s. 100% THC is classified by the food and drug law as Schedule 3. So if we're concerned, CBD, by the way, is there's no argument about that. There is not a single...
Ma'am,
yes,
you,
excuse me.
In what size doses, ma'am?
Oh, well, it comes in different doses. It comes in 5 and 10 milligrams, and I think also 2.5. But 10 milligrams, quite a lot of this, 100% THC. And some patients are prescribed multiple pills a day of this. In fact, I have been. And I would talk to you about that in private, but it's 100% THC, which is what we're so scared of. And that's my point. I just wanted to present this information to put this whole thing in context, and I hope that that's helpful.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I'm Regina Whitsett. I'm with Community Coalitions of Virginia and SAFE. My sympathies to the people who have talked about family members who have Crohn's. Actually, my sister was diagnosed with Crohn's and has had many hospitalizations. However, I'm here to speak in opposition to this bill because there are already effective treatment options that exist for Crohn's disease. Additionally, and the CBD, THC, oils are not FDA-approved medicines. And that is the only way to ensure that there's the proper dosage, there's patient safety, there's no side effects, and there's no drug interactions. And I wanted to pass out some handouts and reports that I have as well, if I could do that, please. This is on this bill, but also on... Patron Levine's bill as well. There's several studies there. The first study that is attached is from the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine. And it is an overall report. This is from January of 2017. It talks about the therapeutic effects of marijuana. It talks about cancer, respiratory disease, other issues, but it does not specifically say anything about Crohn's. It says that more study needs to be done in that area. The second report that is attached is an American Academy of Family Physicians, and they affirm their medical professional stance is that medical marijuana preparations be strictly regulated by the FDA in order to assure safety, purity, and effectiveness. The third report there is something that has just come out recently, and this is from the FDA, where these are warning letters in 2015 and 2016 that talk about the CBD oils, how the products were seriously mislabeled and how it's hard to tell what CBD amount is in each oil. So there are FDA warning labels there that have been introduced. And as the one lady mentioned, there are already FDA-approved drugs on the market, Marinol and Sesamet. And all states that have legalized marijuana began with medical marijuana. And when some people were mentioning that these oils help them to not use the painkillers or the opiates, we actually have a doctor's presentation from Harvard Medical School where she will tell you that if you use marijuana, there's cannabinoids in your brain. Those cannabinoid receptors actually make you crave opiates. So since we have this big opioid heroin problem in our country, marijuana use can actually trigger to where people go to that drug further down the line. So with those things being said, we oppose this bill.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Kevin Carroll for Chairman of the Police. All I would say is my sympathies do go out to the people who are currently struggling with Crohn's disease, and I would say that if we're going to have a study done, then perhaps this would be something good to study to determine whether or not it should be done. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Melanie Crevo. I am a licensed veterinarian in Virginia. So I know that we're not talking about animals today, but listening to some of the objections just from a point of view of being a prescriber in the state of Virginia, some of the things that caught my attention is when the woman stated that the FDA approved drugs ensure safety, no side effects, and no interactions. I think anybody who watches televisions can recognize that that's not true. We have a whole list of side effects listed in every commercial that we hear, and many of those, you'll notice, are death. So just because the FDA approves a drug does not mean that it is safe. And oftentimes, it means that it's effective. But as a prescriber, a veterinary prescriber, many drugs that are on the market, we will use that were approved for one condition, we can use them for other conditions. This holds true in human medicine as well. So this whole FDA is good in that they're looking for safety and efficacy, but we are certainly in all fields using drugs that are not entirely safe, not completely efficacious, and often for conditions that they were not originally approved. So I think that's something to consider. And in conjunction with this bill, we're talking about I'm familiar with the statement that she brought up about the cease and desist letters for the CBD companies. These were not CBD companies. They're operating under a license. CBD is treated right now in many places as an herbal product. So there is no regulation in many places. Here in Virginia, where we have regulations through the Board of Pharmacy, through this previous epilepsy bill, to make sure that the product that we put to market for these patients for Crohn's actually represents what it says it represents. So I think that that is an argument that doesn't apply in this particular case here in Virginia. So I just wanted to bring that up.
Thank you. Yes, sir. You're the last one on the topic. Go ahead.
Yes, my name is Duke Dunn. I started an organization, SOS PAC, Saving Our Society, Police and Citizens Together, but I changed it because people started frowning upon it where the police and citizens changed it to pulling all communities together for causes like this. And talking about DA, the public don't care what the DA was made and formed on lies to the public with the hemp and the cannabis to outlaw it, and that, you know, so their bias, you know, their income relies upon it. But there's a group in outside Charlottesville called the Medical Cannabis Institute. You can get courses online for patients and for caregivers that will validate about this, about CBD oil and medical cannabis for the benefit of the people as well. There was a group that came out, the National Academic of Science and Medicine, and that said that it validated that there's medical benefits from the cannabis. And also DARE, if you all remember going to school, used to promote that marijuana was bad, but I believe about 5 years ago they stopped doing that, and they actually stated, I've heard people say that it's not a gateway drug to these drugs. The gateway drug to the heroin is the big pharma stuff, the fentanyl, the Percocet, all that, that gives that. And a lot of people that were doing, actually, I know a lady friend of my daughter's that actually died, and I went to her funeral this past fall. She was doing marijuana, but she had an ASAP program, couldn't do it because she had to do the urine test. And so she fell back for her pain and doing the painkillers, and then she ended up slipping doing heroin, and she's dead now. And so we need to open this up for the people. It's proved. I mean, the patent governor, I mean, the government patented in 2003 that it had medical benefits. And there's a group also in Virginia called Patients Out of Time. And our veterans also need it. That was Veterans Day 2 years ago. We dumped about 1,000 pill bottles on the White House sidewalk as well because of pain. Veterans commit, and they're giving this thing that 22 veterans commit suicide every day. And we need, you know, to help our veterans. We need to help our kids, our people. And you're here to represent your constituents. And right now, the polls, Gallup, everybody knows nationwide, they say over 60% of the public wants it all legalized. They say 80% plus wants it medicated. So this is the constituents and the people, and that's what we want, and that's what we need. And we need to at least get this decriminalized deal going, you know, because it's put hardships on families. I've been having to play poppy in my grandchild, and a lot of other people, and it wrecks their lives. They get this record on their life, and it's just wrong. And this medicine, it also helps with cancer, the CBD oils. It's the only thing that's approved. There's this guy, Rick Sims. He's like a guru with it, and you can check. And then there's also the Cancer Institute even validates that it has medical conditions. So, you know, this needs to be approved for the public and the people. You're hearing when this is, there's much more evidence out there. In this school, you need to check out where you can learn and get your people to check out. Thank you.
Sir, I'm sorry. I hear you saying the evidence is out there. All of us on this panel have agreed that we are willing to go down this road when somebody meets a burden of proof. It would be nice if the evidence was in here. I still haven't heard the evidence. I've heard anecdotes. I've heard this lady. I trust this lady, everything she just said. That's not going to do it for me, though, okay? We need some science in here, and I appreciate your zeal in caring about this matter, but you didn't say anything that the only evidence I have in my hand is from the lady who says this is a bad idea. That's all I have in my hand right now is things that would give me pause, okay?
One of the things she said that DARE kind of validates now is, well, it's not a gateway drug. Marijuana is not a gateway. Cannabis, actually, and talking about that from 1850 to 1937.
We're talking about, sir, whether CBD oil helps you with your Crohn's disease, okay?
Okay.
That's all that I would like to see some proof that that is true.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Chairman, Delegate Albo. So as a follow-up to Delegate Gilbert's thought, you know, I made a commitment that if someone can show me medical evidence that it helps, I'm going to try to give it to them, okay? Well, I was online before my computer ran out of juice, and I just emailed it to you. There's a National Institute of Health website publication from some study that was going on that was supposed to be finished soon or just recently, and the website's not updated, but it's U.S. National Institute of Health. It's not some kind of, I like to smoke pot, and here's my study site.
It's almost done. I think they say it's almost complete.
Yeah, so now, if you could get... You could call the Institute of Health up or get us something that would be able to, we could hang our hat on, then I'd vote for the bill. Because my problem is that I have to treat everybody the same. I treat everybody fairly. My standard is you give me peer-reviewed scientific evidence and it helps people, I'm going to vote for it. If you don't have it, I feel bad for you, but I'm not.
Well, if I may address that in a couple of comments that were made, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the lady giving us the stuff from the Coalitions of Virginia. She had mentioned that it said that more work needs to be done on Crohn's. I just scanned through this. I didn't see anything where you mentioned the Crohn's on there. I would also argue that that a lot of the concern, I'm actually reading some of this stuff, and it actually says cannabinoids aren't effective for acute pain, but for some pain it works. I'm not quite sure what this really has to do with Crohn's. What I will tell you, sir, is that this body, in its wisdom, set the precedent that when a bar is reached, it is willing to allow the use of cannabis oil for treatment. And I know there's a couple of bars that was set. The first bar is that this had to be a life-threatening disease. It had to be something that truly impacted the welfare of a person's life. And I hope we can all agree that Crohn's disease is one of those diseases. It is life-threatening, it is debilitating, it has everything that you probably looked at when you looked at epilepsy. The second thing, the bar that was set by this committee, was that there cannot be alternative treatments available to be taken to reach some semblance of normalcy. And the best source I could find on that was the Mayo Clinic. And I don't think any of us could ever, you know, discount the Mayo Clinic. And when I went through all those drugs, and keep in mind, you don't just take an anti-inflammatory or an immune suppressor. It's not pick one of these 20. Is pick one from column A, two from column B, three from column C, and that's what you take. And
you'll talk to people about, they took 21 pills. Find me two pills that you want to take. One causes cancer, one causes liver disease, one causes brain disease. So right now we have a life-threatening disease. I've got treatments that by Mayo Clinic's own accord, some of these treatments don't actually have an impact, but they're still prescribing them. And the ones that have an impact by the Mayo Clinic's own accord can't be taken by some of the patients with Crohn's. And if they can, if it does supposedly have an impact and it can't be taken, the side effect could be cancer or brain disease. So I think we've reached that bar. Now I've got the third bar to reach. And that third bar is the toughest. And that's the one that says cannabis oil has been proven to make a difference. Now, as a delegate, I appreciate, and I'm aware of the study, I'm trying to get some type of insight on this. It was the study that came on the backside of the smoking study that you see in front of you. I've supplied one article about where cannabis oil is inflammatory and can reduce pain we take and help Crohn's disease and actually prevents additional surgeries. But I don't have that study, but I can give you 15 to 20 more articles that say exactly what the one in front of you says, which is it impacts, it's there for autoimmune diseases. It helps with inflammation. It helps with Crohn's disease. I just can't give you that, you know, that study that puts 10 patients over here and 20 patients over here. But I also can, oh, yes, sir.
Okay, so you could wrap it up.
Okay, sir, yeah. Well, but so
third of the way through our document.
Sure. So my last statement would be, so if I reach two of the bars, that third bar, you're just going to have to take the test by people like Nikki, because they've done this, and I've heard it from a lot of other people. And even if you won't buy, there's 10 or 20 or 30 Nikki's out there, I guarantee you there's at least five. And five Nikki's is enough for us to allow being able to take this drug, not have to take opioids and go down that route, and not have to take drugs that honestly probably are more detrimental to their health than the disease they're afflicted with to begin with.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Delegate Davis. Thank you, ma'am, for testifying. All right, we have House Bill 2135, Delegate Levine, and then we have Delegate 1704 to follow.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. The 2135, first, I'd ask that the amendment nature substitute be agreed to by this committee.
Take a motion to adopt the sub. If you don't move, favor say, favor say aye.
So the sub does is it adds cannabinoid oils to treatment of cancer. And I'm proud to say that I do have NIH peer-reviewed scientific studies that I'm about to share with the committee. Just briefly, I would note that the current treatment for cancer includes opioids, includes benzos, includes highly addictive, highly toxic substance, unlike cannabinoid oils. And that these oils, it should be very, very clear, they don't get you high. You cannot smoke them. They're drops. And the exciting thing, and the reason that I'm going to share these studies in a second, is that they actually do a lot of good. I have studies from NIH and the New Jersey Medical School, from GW, from University of Washington, from British Journal of Pharmacology, one in Italy, one in Israel. But the two of them, and actually the original study was at UVA, it had this effect in 1975. But the real exciting ones, I'm going to share with you two of them that I'd like to share with the committee are from right across the way from VCU and also from Harvard Medical School. I'd like to distribute these. Here's the, these are two separate studies. They're just stapled together for convenience. And here's the exciting thing in these two studies. If you look on the front page, and I've underlined it, this is the study from Virginia Commonwealth University Medical School. It says that plant-derived cannabinoids induce apoptosis in leukemic cells. In other words, they kill leukemic cells. It leads to cell death. That's a pretty exciting thing in cancer, given that leukemia obviously will kill you if you don't kill it at first. The second study on the second page from Harvard Medical School shows the power of these cannabinoids to work with chemotherapy. Now, obviously, chemotherapy, while necessary to survive, is in itself a poison, extremely dangerous. And what the Harvard study shows is that for non-small cell lung cancer, which is the leading cause of cancer deaths worldwide, there are only limited therapeutic treatments. And they looked at cannabinoid receptors, and they found that they significantly attenuated random as well as growth factor-directed in vitro chemotaxis and chemoinvasion in these cells. In other words, the chemotherapy doesn't kill the cells that we don't want to kill. It actually helps, and it, you see in the next line that I've underlined, inhibit in vivo tumor growth and lung metastasis. The people that I have to testify will tell you that they've suffered from cancer, that the chemo drugs, although perhaps necessary to save their lives, can cause kidney damage, nerve damage, nausea and vomiting, hearing loss, disturbance in balance, and other things that, again, by limiting the impact of the chemotherapy, as the Harvard Medical Study shows, can actually help them. So, Delegate Albo, you rightly ask for peer-reviewed National Institute of Health science, and I've tried to provide that for you today.
Delegate Albo. On that second study, it says CB1, CB2. Is that cannabinoid oil?
They are cannabinoid receptors, CB1 and CB2.
How do I know? Maybe your witness would.
My witnesses know more about this than I do, I assure you.
Okay, what I can know is this cannabinoid oil, or THCA oil, is that what you're talking about in this Harvard study?
I believe so, but again, my experts know more about this than I do, and they will certainly testify in a minute. Thank you.
You have somebody who would like to present some information, please.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening. Tell us your name and tell us your thoughts on this measure.
My name is Brian Wilson.
Hi, Mr. Wilson.
Currently, been diagnosed with a fibromyxoid sarcoma that I'm using this oil with success to treat. I just got back from Texas, surgery down in Texas, where they had attempted to go in and try to get some of the tumor out as much as they could. Unfortunately, they were not able to get to any of it. It's wrapped in this area called the cavernous sinus, deep up here, my head, it's wrapped around the carotid artery, the place where the carotid artery is the thinnest. So radiation is out of the question. The only treatment that they have offered, and I'm going back down to speak with my oncologist again in a couple weeks, is chemotherapy. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that. Before I went into surgery, I got the opportunity to sit there with my neurosurgeon and go over some of my imaging. One that was, you know, 2 or 3 months old, and another one that was only a few days old. And we got to look at the tumor size and some of infection that I had going on up here as well. And to our surprise, well, I guess, I don't know, maybe not surprised, we were very excited to see that the tumor had gotten swollen. And the only thing that can be attributed to this is the cannabis oil. So this is putting me in a position where I'm considering, and I've heard people, other people do this before, being able to turn down chemotherapy and continue with this cannabis oil rep, which is incredibly empowering. It takes me out of the danger and the effects, all the negative effects of chemotherapy. I'm floored. I'm beside myself. I'm so happy with this stuff. And it's helped me in many other ways. There's things that that go along with this diagnosis and being sick. It's hard to put into words. Symptoms, things that kind of start moving against you, your appetite, have problems with. And just a lot of everyday things that normally we don't think of. Normally they're not a problem. And since I've started this oil, all these things have come flooding back. I cannot speak enough about this stuff. And I'm just really excited about it. And I really, really hope that you guys would really take a very good look at this, because this is saving people. And it's saving me right now. So, anybody have any questions for me?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, committee members. Thank you for your thoughtful considerations and suggestions. I really do appreciate this opportunity to address this legislation again this session. I look to you all for direction in helping patients like myself and Brian, who are the fortunate ones who can stand before you today to testify on behalf of those who cannot because they're in the hospital or they're dead. You've heard my story before, and briefly, my daughter was one the first time I was diagnosed with lymphoma. After 12 doses of chemotherapy, I thought it was over. And 6 months later, they told me unequivocally, you will die, or you have one option. I was given one option that had an okay chance, maybe, if you live through the therapy, if you live through your stem cell transplant. You know, that's your only chance for a cure. There's a 20% chance that you're not coming out of that hospital room just by having that chemotherapy for the transplant alone. The chemotherapy that I had causes leukemia. I'm in a desperate rush to beat my next relapse, to beat leukemia that I watched my aunt at the same age that I was, my first diagnosis, not live through. We've heard a lot of testimony about the palliative benefits of these oils and how it mitigates nausea, helps with pain. But what's critical for cancer patients is that it offers curative options. I firmly believe that there are palliative benefits, of course. But that's not the hope, and that's not what makes this critical. Okay. CBD, as we all know, is non-psychoactive. It's been shown in multiple studies, some of them, to kill cancer cells, to prevent their proliferation, to keep tumors from forming blood supplies, and to work synergistically with many current first-line chemotherapies, greatly increasing their efficacy while at the same time mitigating cellular damage. I have hearing loss, profound joint damage, damage to my heart muscle, damage to my lungs, pulmonary fibrosis from one of my chemotherapies. The therapies that we're presented with are toxic and often fatal. And these simple, non-psychoactive cannabidiol compounds are helping to turn that apoptosis mechanism back on. So you have cancer, when the cell goes bad, something's wrong in the cell, it's supposed to self-destruct. And when it doesn't self-destruct, and it keeps replicating in this bad form, that's what cancer is. And to create that
these cannabinoids work to correct that the bond, the covalent bond that's broken, and then apoptosis can happen, and the cell can self-destruct, and this tumor can't keep going and going and going. And that's the really important discovery that we made here in the 70s at UVA, and it's, you know, basically the citation number one over and over in these cannabis and cancer studies. We've had that data before us for years. We talk about FDA data. GW Pharmaceuticals, who we've all met here, working on Epidiolex, they're completing the phase 3 clinical trials right now on their Sativex drug, which includes both the CBD and the THC cannabinoids. They're showing that when you use this spray on for brain cancer, glioblastoma patients who do not have a good chance of, that they don't have a good 5-year outlook. So they're using the spray in their mouth with their regular chemo, and the people who are using the spray are having a 30% increase on the efficacy of their chemotherapy. That's all they're adding is a couple sprays in their mouth. We are prescribed. The interesting thing about epilepsy and Crohn's and cancer patients is that we take a lot of the same drugs. We all take the same opiates, we take the same benzodiazepines, sleep medications, high doses of steroids, dexamethasone, antivirals, anti-anxiety meds, sleep medications, I mean, you name it, it goes on. And a lot of it starts with controlling pain because cancer is painful. The therapies that you take to survive it are very painful. And once you start taking opiates, there's a host of other medications that you have to take with it. This is not about getting high. These patients, Brian, myself, we can have all of the opiates we want. We can have all of the pure, unmitigated THC we want. In fact, we were talking earlier about Marinol and how it's dosed. So you would take a 5-milligram Marinol tablet 3 hours before you get chemotherapy, so it can start to work on your nausea. Then you can take another tablet every 2 to 4 hours, 6 times a day. And that's just to manage your nausea for chemotherapy. It's synthetic, so it's not having the same synergistic effect that it does with CBD on your cellular level. So the synthetic THC doesn't offer as many fantastic benefits. Okay, so you've heard my story, you've heard Brian's, and I would like to answer any questions you have.
Yes, ma'am. Tell it up. So on the second study, the Harvard study that Delegate Levine brought, okay? Now remember, I'm just a suburban lawyer, right? This stuff doesn't make sense to me. I want you to explain to me in regular person talk the last sentence. These results suggest that CB1 and CB2 could be used as novel therapeutic targets against non-small cell lung cancer. What does that mean?
That means the CB1 and CB2 receptors. So we have an endocannabinoid system in our body. We all make cannabinoids in our body. The first time you have a really high dose of cannabinoids, as most humans, is in breast milk. It's filled with cannabinoids. And this is where it kind of starts to make sense. Your endocannabinoid system, there's a lot of it, a lot of receptors, these CB1 and CB2 up in your head, really concentrated all through your head, through your lung and heart area, and very much in your digestive tract. So these receptors, when it's breast milk in your infant, these compounds are coming in and making your infant's gut will often be referred to as leaky gut, and it's kind of open, and when you put these cannabinoids in there, they bond with these receptors and help fill out and complete your...
This says me.
It means that
if someone took CBD oil,
yes,
it would get into these receptors,
yes,
and would help with non-small lung cell cancer.
Correct, okay. Correct. And eliciting that apoptosis that makes the bad cells shut down.
Thank you.
I'm just a mom. I'm not even an attorney.
Well, I mean, you sound like you went to medical school. I mean, you are an expert in this issue, right?
I had cancer twice, so
I
had to.
You have become an expert not of your own choosing, right?
Absolutely, trial by fire.
Right. You know, and if it were me or any of mine, I would do anything in the world to try to make people I love feel better and find whatever magic oil that'll do the trick. But you were here last year, right?
Yes, sir.
And your testimony was compelling last year, and it was compelling just now. But I personally have not heard a single thing about you your particular issue, this bill, as it exists right now?
My particular issue?
Well, I mean, I haven't heard a thing about it since last year. And again, we're being asked on the fly to make all these judgments about your assessment of the scientific evidence off of one sheet of paper. And it seems to me like we had a year to work on this and to be convinced and to be, educated. And I would love that. And again, I have shown through my vote that I'm willing to go down this road. But I've only gone down this road because people have put the time and effort into convincing me that I needed to do that. And I'm not saying that your testimony isn't compelling. I'm just saying I haven't heard a thing about it since you did it last year. And I do continue to feel like there's a burden of proof that exists out there that must be shown before we go down the road that we're being asked to go down. I've said it before, I'll say it. I'm saying it. I said it on the last issue, and I have to tell that to you again. So, again, I'm open to it. I think we're collectively open to it. I just, again, I haven't, since last year, 15 minutes ago was the first time I've heard anything about it. So, I need to be convinced, is all I'm saying to you. But I appreciate everything you've gone through, and you may get me yet, okay? But I haven't heard it yet today. Okay.
Thank you. Any other members of the public like to be heard on this measure?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, again, I'm Regina Whitsett. In the study that I gave to you from the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine, it does state that there are therapeutic effects for nausea and vomiting and chronic pain, but it doesn't say anything about actually helping to treat cancer. So I just want to bring that to your attention. And CECOVA has been sending reports to senators and delegates throughout the past year with everything we find on marijuana, any studies we have out of Colorado, Washington, anything like that. But I do want to point out about this bill that this is for, it's all inclusive. It's for 160 different types of cancer.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, and that includes skin cancer. And also in that National Academy of Science report, it says that it indicates there is no or insufficient evidence that cannabinoids are an effective treatment for cancer. So with that being said, we oppose this bill.
Ma'am, question for you, Mr. Chair.
So
the CBD oil, it's non-psychoactive, but you'd all at least agree with that?
No, we do not agree with that. And I'm not a scientist, and everyone, there's lots of people in this room that will probably disagree with me, but we've been doing research on this since last year when we were told that the CBD THC oils are not psychoactive, they don't have hallucinogenic effects. On that last form in the packet that I gave you, that's an email that we had sent to you all over the past year that has three different links that tell you how to make THCA oil into THC. And it's basically called a deep carboxylation process. And when you heat up the THCA, it intensifies that effect and it becomes THC. So no, we're not in agreement that those oils are not cannot be psychoactive.
That they cannot be?
We do not agree with that.
Okay. But you agree with it that in that form, the THCA, before it's so converted, does not create the psychoactive effects of...
No, we actually do not agree with that either,
okay,
because we have sent you guys a chart that shows...
I didn't see any of that, so just tell me about it.
So Georgia and Virginia are the only ones that have 5% THC in the oils from the intractable epilepsy bills. And when I was on the Board of Pharmacy Regulatory Panel, I argued that that's too high. All of the rest of the medical marijuana states in the country is 0.3 or 0.3%. The 5% THC level is what used to be in marijuana in the 70s. And as some people have testified here today, that's not what's out there right now. It's 25% on the average in Colorado.
Do you disagree that it has any of these medicinal effects for the specific cancers that have been suggested today?
Well, I just mentioned that according to the report, there are therapeutic effects for nausea and vomiting, but also Marinol and Sesamet will help with that as well. So we are following the scientific evidence,
of whether or not it has effects. But also in the same report, it talks about there's a modest evidence that cannabis use is associated with types of testicular cancer, and it's harmful in pregnancy. So there's other things that say it's harmful.
So if we were talking about making Marinol legal, would you be against that?
Marinol is.
I understand it is. Where are you against it being legal?
Marinol is a FDA approved.
I understand. Are you against that?
No.
Why not?
It's FDA approved.
Okay.
With clinical trials and on numerous patients, and so no, Marinol's already on the market and can be used for some of these things that are side effects of cancer.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Any other questions?
All right. Any other member of the public like to be heard on this issue? Matters before the panel? Delegate Alba. Research. I mean, I got my own bills, but I'm sitting here looking at the NIH website on cannabinoids, and it does say that they are effective. Cannabinoids can be effective in treating chemotherapy.
That's correct.
Is there any studies that show that they have been tested by a scientific group like the National Institute of Health to help cancer, not the side effects of the chemo?
Yes, and I believe Ms. Peeney knows all about that.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. GW Pharmaceuticals is in clinical trials right now with that preparation containing THC and CBD for glioblastoma. And it is showing that in conjunction with first-line chemotherapy, first drug they prescribe you that works the best, temozolomide, it's increasing the temozolomide efficacy by 30%. Most of that, there's the final report isn't published, and that's pretty typical. As it gets closer to for them to release it, they tend to pull off the preliminaries.
That follow-up, Delegate Alba. Okay, so, yeah, if this thing doesn't pass this subcommittee, I'll make the same offer that I made for the Crohn's. I mean, yeah, we're going to work 14 hours today. I don't have time to do the work. I need a document from the National Institute of Health says we've got peer-reviewed studies that show that CBD and THCA oil can help. Because I can't really rely on, I can't legislate on my iPhone, you know what I mean?
Of course not.
This wouldn't be fair to my constituents to do that. So,
Delegate Watts. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My comment will be somewhat similar to that. Last year, in a similar study, in a similar conversation, I believe that what was given to us several days later was a packet that had 17 or 20 studies in it. I stuck it away. Someday I'm going to be literally buried in paper when it's all over with. But I did look through it several months later, and I read much more than I thought I would because it was quite interesting about shrinking cancer cells and tumors, etc. I will find that packet, I will give it to you, to Delegate Davis, and hopefully the homework that we're all looking for is in fact available. Because again, it has to come from all of you who have a network that can put this together properly.
I would just say, Delegate Alba, that the first study I gave you for Virginia Commonwealth University does say quite clearly at the top that it kills cancer cells. And I have two more studies if you want to see them. I've highlighted the appropriate parts. One is from the NIH itself, and the other is this GW study that's not quite finished in its clinical trial. I'd be happy to hand it to you now or email it to you.
Mr. Chairman. Delegate
Klein.
For the cancer, going to the underlying cancer is more promising. And we worked really hard last year, and I worked really hard last year to come up with a bill that could pass on epilepsy specifically, because the oil went to the underlying illness. And so that's what I'm looking for here. And so I'm hopeful.
This is the midpoint. That was 16 mills. We have 17 to go. They're not quite as big, but there's certainly several significant issues left to go. All right, we have Delegate Pillicor, Council 1704. At some point, everybody, we're going to take about a 10 or 15 minute break just to get some food, but we're not going to be working until that time. Delegate Pillicor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Amendment needed to substitute, and I also have an article I can pass around as well. That's a gift for you, Mr. Chairman.
Probably 10 times. I'm new to this this issue, but it's important. Basically, HB 1704 addresses the low felony larceny threshold in Virginia. So what it's going to do is change it from its current rate of 200 to 500. And I'd like to also note that the bill does not cover property crimes resulting in damage. Before I start, officially, I also passed around an article I think you all would be interested to read from our former Attorney General, Ken Cuccinelli. And Cuccinelli, who is enthusiastically supporting this bill. Thank you, starting with $200. So what are we talking about when we're talking about a $200 item? A pair of Air Jordans, a smartphone, a good quality vacuum cleaner, several tires for your car. These are only a few examples of what $200 can buy, and it's not obviously an exhaustive list. The majority of you all have heard this bill, your attorneys, and I know you're fully aware better than I am, actually, of, you know, the difference between larceny and misdemeanor as a felony. But as you also know, a felony clearly creates lifelong barriers to employment, to housing, to education, and so many other opportunities. Currently in the Commonwealth of Virginia, you're also aware that we have one of the lowest thresholds in the nation. In 2016, I'm not sure if you all, if this was discussed last time, but the Pew Charitable Trust published a study which examined the crime trends in 23 states, all of whom had raised the threshold between 2001 and 2011. And I found it very interesting to note that property crimes and larceny rates continued to decline in all 23 states that raised their threshold. The study further concluded that the amount of the state's felony theft threshold was not correlated with its property crime or larceny rates, which I think is important. Many of those that are in opposition to this bill contend that some larcenies are carried out by organized groups or by gangs rather than individuals that act alone. They argue that these criminal enterprises, more so than individuals, are actually aware of this low threshold, felony threshold, and purposely do what they can to avoid purposely avoid states with lower thresholds. The panel from the same group, Blueprints for Change, acknowledged that these groups do exist, but at the same time, prosecutors and attorneys who are part of this panel argued that seldom, if ever, have they encountered thieves who actually are part of these organized criminal organizations. The stakeholders, mostly the retail merchants, accepted that such groups probably account for a small fraction of the thefts suffered by businesses. And they're right. At the end of the day, these crimes are not generally committed by masterminds, criminal masterminds, but rather committed by those who live in extreme poverty and those who are addicted to drugs. So instead of charging them with a misdemeanor and sending them to local city and county jails, where it's easier to return to society after serving time, they're instead shipped off to our state prisons, where more naive first-time offenders can be hardened criminals and addicts become addicted to even harder drugs, as the studies have shown. Lastly, I believe strongly that this is good for our budget. We all know that every department has to tighten their belts, and the Department of Public Safety is no different here, as you'll hear soon from our secretary. I know that many of you are also concerned about the cuts that may come to state correctional facilities in all of our districts. Three of you actually even have prisons in your districts. Some would argue that voting yes on this bill perhaps arguably doesn't translate into being tough on crime. I disagree. It's hard to quantify and compare the short and long-term costs using dollars and cents. But research shows, as I mentioned earlier in the Blueprints for Change, that a felony conviction increases the risk of future offending. I believe strongly also, and I think some improvement of this bill will have a positive revenue impact. Number one, taxpayers pay for attorneys appointed who don't need them. Number two, our cops are taken off the street instead of resolving those that are on their regular dockets. And three, clerks then aren't wasting time, extra time on dockets. It makes the entire system, I argue, more efficient. At the end of the day, this bill is not only tough on crime, it's also smart for our budget. With me today, I have the Secretary of Public Safety, Brian Moran, and also the City of Radford Commonwealth Attorney, Chris Rehak. We both would like to speak. It's okay with the Chairman and the Committee.
Mr. Chairman. Yeah. All right, so, anybody have any questions?
Yes. How is it tough on crime again? Tell me that part.
I think the bottom line here is that we need to move forward. We need to make a difference here where we can. Clearly, we're one of the last lowest states, and it's time that we move forward. And as you can see, even from others that are of the other political persuasion, they too have agreed that this is not being solved on crime. This is moving in the right direction. You're going to reduce crime, not increase it. And the majority of these thefts, as I mentioned earlier, was we saw from Blueprints for Change.
Mr. Chair. So you didn't answer my question, but you just said something that makes me have another question. How does it de-incentivize crime to make the penalties lower?
Mr. Chairman, I think actually if we can first hear from the Secretary.
Okay, if you don't want to answer that one either, that's fine. But
Mr. Chairman, if I might. I know we've heard these arguments, and we can go back. I know we do this every year, 10 years. But I think some of these points that I have made and some of this information is new, has come out of some of these studies. And I think as we look around the country and look at where we're in, the fiscal constraints that we're in now, I think this is prudent, timely, makes sense. But I do have the Secretary here.
Well, let's just talk about it. So the state that gets cited is Texas, is that right? The editorial you handed out talked about Texas.
Yes.
As a place we should emulate, right? Mm-hmm. Now, Texas imprisons at a higher rate than Virginia does it not? These are not. I mean, and the crime rate isn't close, you're correct. While we are the 41st lowest state, Texas is the 16th highest state. That's for nonviolent. For violent, it's even worse, 48 and 16. The state which we're being asked to emulate pays more, puts more people in prison, and gets a worse outcome than we do. Okay.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. All right. Any other member of the panel have any questions for the patron? You have someone you'd like to speak in your behalf?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Yes,
Secretary of Public Safety, please.
Secretary Moran, welcome back. Happy to hear your thoughts on the bill.
Mr. Chairman, recognizing this has been a perennial issue before this court, I actually assembled a group 2 years ago, Blueprints for Change, stakeholders from the Retail Merchant Association and others, prosecutors, judges. And the concerns expressed by retail merchants were two. The low threshold discourages embezzlement, and then it also discourages these organized gang types that Delegate Philicorn addressed. But the Pew study, which you know, is new to this debate, and the comparison of states would indicate that just the opposite is true, that when they compare Pennsylvania and Florida, Florida $300, Pennsylvania raised theirs to 1,000, actually Pennsylvania experienced fewer property and larceny rates. And as the chairman knows and members of the committee, embezzlement is treated differently in the courts. The experience is that it's treated more punitive. I think the judges recognize that stealing in a relationship of trust is punishable differently. So I do think now, 27 years after, 37 years, I'm sorry, 37 years after it had, was raised from 100 to 200, it is now appropriate for us to move in the direction of other states. Texas, that the chairman mentioned, is $2,500. Wisconsin is $2,500. Those are the two states that former Attorney General Ken Cuccinelli referenced. I would reference just our neighboring states. North Carolina, Maryland, West Virginia all have $1,000. They continue to have retail merchants. They continue to have functioning commerce. So why can't the Commonwealth? And the cost that is associated with this, the court-appointed fees, arresting, bringing them to court, assigning them court-appointed both in general district court and then in circuit court, you know, it is costly to society. And
what do you think the cost is? So I'm just looking. So North Carolina, again, we're 41st, so 9th at the bottom. North Carolina's 19th. I have to look at the breakdown. But that's the property crime ranking based on all property crimes that they have. And then you said Maryland's 28th. Those are not places we would ever want to emulate. You're a prosecutor. The damages caused by a crime greatly exceed anything like restitution, and they put everything from loss prevention to people not feeling safe to people shutting down businesses. This will make life a lot easier for thieves in Virginia. I mean, they'll love it. And the other states that have much higher crime rates will be delighted because our crime rate will climb and maybe theirs will fall. But why is it good policy for us?
Mr. Chairman, I would just challenge your conclusions there that the $200 to $500 is going to lead to those types of results.
But you're the one who suggested we should look at what other states are doing and change what we do to emulate them. And that would make sense if we could look at what they're doing and say, gosh, they're seeing success or we're seeing failure. I'm not pretending that I can unpack all the things that go into why our crime rate is low, but it certainly wouldn't be that I would look to them and say, that's something we'd like to do. But, okay, I cut you off. Go ahead. I won't do it again.
No,
all right.
Mr. Chair.
Delegate Gilbert.
Mr. Secretary, can you tell us how many people are in the Department of Corrections right now for larceny?
First offense, Mr. Chairman, Delegate Gilbert, for a first offense larceny, I don't think it'd be anybody in the state correctional facility. Well, what happens, Mr. Chairman? Mr. Gilbert, as you well know, what happens in many of these cases, the prosecutor may very well reduce, which kind of refutes chairman's. If the 200 to 500 were for many prosecutors, well, we reduce it. As legislative, as their own fiat, their discretion. But they give them a misdemeanor conviction and typically even jail time in our jails to get that type of disposition. I mean, that's costly, and you're giving them a conviction. There has consequences when you have, and frankly, this really diminishes, a felony should mean something.
Okay,
Delegate, and $200 that hasn't kept pace with inflation for 37 years, I think it diminishes the value of what that we place on a felony versus a misdemeanor offense.
And I appreciate the Secretary. I won't get in a running debate with him. I'll just reserve my comments, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Nick.
You have the final vote.
I just didn't want to. I'll spare you the back and forth. Okay.
But we swear we will not interrupt you if you have more than 20 minutes. Twice. Okay. Mr. Secretary, thank you. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, Chris Rehack, I'm the Commonwealth's attorney in Radford. And I'm not representing the Virginia Association of Health Attorneys. I'm just here as the prosecutor in the city of Radford. And I spoke to the secretary about this some weeks ago, and I support this measure. I think this is a common sense realization that this should just be bumped up. I think we're lower than maybe, I think there's one other state that might be lower than our threshold.
That's New Jersey.
Might be.
And they have an even better crime rate on property crimes than we have.
You mentioned Texas. You're aware that there's sweeping reforms right now underway that we saw and heard of in the state of Texas. Bipartisan reforms are underway that are really shocking, but they've come, they have an overcrowding problem, and of course the budget, I think it's 170, I don't even know what the Department of Corrections budget is, but I did an informal survey among some of my senior prosecutors, my colleagues and mentors of mine, and I'm not going to name names, but we could not reach a consensus as the Virginia Association of Commonwealth Attorneys, but there are many prosecutors, very seasoned prosecutors, who also fall into this category of supporting a modest increase for this.
Mr. Chair, do any of those prosecutors have any problem exercising their discretion, such as it is, being unfettered? Do you or any of them have any problem using
it? No, and we routinely do. As the secretary pointed out, if I have a college student who's made a mistake of taking someone's cell phone or laptop out of the campus library, I'm faced with, do I make this young man a felon for the rest of his life and put him on probation and then all of his strings at home? Or maybe do we do petty larceny?
Do you get jail time?
You go to jail for a couple of weekends or a couple of weeks. I'm doing it now.
Mr. Chair, you wouldn't get the jail time, though, if you raised the threshold, right? If they stole $450 worth of stuff, they're going to show up if they get convicted. If they steal $450 worth of stuff and they're charged with petty larceny, they're not going to go to jail, right? The only way they go to jail and learn that lesson, and the secretary was talking about consequences, some of us are focused on consequences for this person to make sure they don't do this again. So you're not going to get the jail time for the $450 watch anymore if we raise the threshold.
You're correct. The things that cost between $200 and $500.
May I ask why you bother to extract the jail time out of somebody now when you let them off the felony? Why do you do that?
Because
it's not important.
It is. It's in exchange for not becoming a felon the rest of your life. And losing privileges that come with the right.
Understood.
Yes.
And you would do that for nothing now, right?
I'm not saying I don't know. It's not happened yet. I haven't really pondered this. It's been 10 years that this has been brought up. That they've been trying to increase this. So nobody's really seriously thought about what's going to be like the day after this gets signed. But point well taken.
I'm sorry.
Point well taken. Okay. And I know there's several of you up there that were prosecutors, and so.
This is the only time I get to think like that anymore is when I'm here for 45 days. The rest of the time, I'm in your office begging you for a better outcome for my client who didn't mean it, who's a good kid.
Right?
Yes. All that. Okay.
So you can appreciate both sides.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, flexibility is key here, but the point is it's just been a long, long time that it's been at $200, and the question is should it be raised to $500 now?
I mean, if you do this, you will lose that flexibility, will you not? I mean, I can't recall the last time it was $50 under the limit about jail. So, I mean, if you're saying it'll be $500 and $450, you're going to go to court, and sometimes that person will get jailed because think that's somehow important.
But again, at 501, I would say that the prosecutors in the Commonwealth are all exercise discretion and are flexible in these things. Does 501 automatically mean you should become a felon?
Oh, it won't happen either. Oh, I agree. Oh, no, that won't happen either. All of a sudden, they will now have to be $700, $800, which is just a little over, isn't it?
On a case-by-case basis, I'd like to think we look at the totality of the circumstances and we do the best we can when we try to know.
Okay, on that point, so right now, I'm just trying to do the math. So I remember when I prosecuted, somebody lost his two-week paycheck. He cashed it out, left it in the car, his no-good friend stole it. Okay, and at the time, the minimum wage was not as high, but he was over the threshold. Now, we thought that was so atrocious. I mean, the other kid had worked for 2 weeks to get the money that was then taken, that even though it was relatively close to the line, we thought that was deserve the higher penalty, as opposed to other ones where it was a single theft and the rest of it. You won't have that flexibility for the $201 to $499 charges. Now, you will absolutely get them at 500 like you do now. And maybe you are one who reduces from 500, but this will reduce your flexibility, not increase it.
It would. The only other point I jotted down that I wanted to make, and you guys know this, especially the members of the committee of the prosecutors, oftentimes when we have grand larceny, we have a burglary or a robbery with it. It is rare that we just have someone who's been walking down the street and jumps on a moped and steals just that. Usually, in my town, it's almost always a burglary or a robbery. So there are heavy penalties that are always wrapped up in most of my grand larceny cases. But thank you.
Other members of the public, I know some of you waited for the chance to testify. Yes, ma'am. Please.
Kim Bogo, Director of Virginia Interfaith Center for Public Policy. We've long supported an increase, and so we support the increase today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Julie Emery, Virginia Civic Engagement Table. We support this bill.
Thank you. Please.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Jody Roth on behalf of the Virginia Retail Federation. We have always opposed this legislation. I agree with the Secretary that a felony should mean something, and to our small business owners, it does mean something. It means deterrent. Most of them have said that it's open season all the way up to the threshold. A lot of them operate on a very tight margin, and they endure many losses before these individuals are even caught. I was a part of the blueprint panel 2 years ago, and all of the presentations indicated that most of these individuals did have significant prior records. So therefore, we do oppose and maintain our position. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Katrina Jones with the Virginia Retail Merchants Association. With all due respect to the Secretary, he mentioned that the retailers are still functioning. And I take issue with that because we have three iconic retailers that have thousands of people that have lost their job in 2016. And retail theft does contribute to loss of sales. And that is the reason that those three iconic retailers have had to close stores. So with all due respect, I disagree on that point. Also, the message of all the other states are doing it really doesn't hold any water with me, because I think that making a decision to stay legislative on trend with other states is not the way to go. We know what's right for Virginia. We're the retailers. We're telling you we need your support. We need help on this issue. Theft is a real problem, and people are losing their jobs, and you are losing tax revenue. So also, one more point. The National Retail Federation did a survey in 2016 and came out with the numbers that these states that have raised their threshold are seeing an uptick in theft. And California, whose threshold is 950, has seen a huge uptick in theft, and they've been considering what to do about it. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Any other member of the public like to be heard in this measure? Delegate,
we
have to give you the last word. Go ahead.
Again, I think I took enough time, but I think for all the reasons I stated in the beginning, I would hope you would move to report this bill. I can see the direction it's going in, and obviously this is not a new topic. You all have heard the arguments time and time again over the last 10 years. Some of the information is new, having said that bill with this blueprint group and several others. I think, again, as I stated earlier, Delegate Gilbert, by taking our police off the streets and focusing on these $200 for the sale, for dealing with people who are stealing sneakers, to me, that's not being tough on crime. And And so, you know, again, I see this differently, and I hope it would be a pleasure of this body to report this bill.
Mr. Chair. I serve Miller first. Motion has been made to table the bill, properly seconded. All in favor of the motion to table, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Yeah, I have the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Watts.
Before people who are interested in this bill leave, could we take up my House Bill 2071, which is on the same topic, and I would very much like to be able to present it briefly.
Sure.
Thank you. I too have seen it for, yeah, I'll be right here. I too have seen it for 35 years as we've dealt with this $200 threshold. My bill says that for a juvenile, since our law reads that any conviction, if a juvenile was found guilty of a delinquent act, which would be a felony if committed by an adult, the records are retained. So this juvenile, for the $200 offense, is then has a felony record for the rest of their lives. And so what my bill does is say that if the juvenile has committed just one offense, and the amount was under $750, and the juvenile has not been adjudicated delinquent of any other violation of the clause, that then the records would be expunged. And so that you don't have a lifetime of checking the box that you were found guilty of a felony. When I first developed this last year, I've been told by several who operate in the juvenile field that this would make a significant difference to a substantial number who are carrying that record. So while I only this morning heard back from the Supreme Court that they would have problems administering this, therefore I am going to ask that it be stricken. But I really encourage those, I've seen this battle that we just heard for 35 years. This is a way of very targeted going after those that have been caught up in while they did something wrong that my kids would get a really strong reaction from me for, it was still stupid, dumb, and perhaps uninformed, and I'm not sure what we want to mark them for the rest of their lives. And with that, I would move to strike House Bill 2071.
Okay. Motion is made to strike House Bill 2071. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, let me ask staff.
You want to do it? Well, let's co-chair.
You want to eat between bills, not in the middle of one. Right. Is the food there?
Yes.
Okay. Everybody, so it is 6:15. We're gonna eat for as quick as we can, so we'll try to get back. Yeah, finish the second block.
Halfway done.
So we will return at 6:30 and take up the third block. Thank you.